the world is a safe place. The world is a dangerous place. Which is it? Dr. Nick joined us with more.
We're going to have everybody more confused.
Whitney, it's a dichotomy of life.
Thank you. Can there be a truth in both statements?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Is there? Absolutely. The reason why I guess I've been so into this question is because in my office, when people come in, the primary thing I want them is to feel safe.
Yes.
Safe, meaning you can talk here, you can say what you want, you're not going to be hurt, I'm not going to shame you, right?
Right.
I may challenge you, but I'm not. But I'm always saying safety, safety, safety. Then I get to thinking about real life. Who's really that safe? Isn't the world sometimes dangerous, hostile? You're a parent.
Right.
Do we want to keep our kids in dock at the bay? Do we want to keep them hidden in the darkness of a closet and never go out and face?
We can't.
Are hurricanes safe? Are floods safe? No.
Right.
But we have, what, resilience? I would hope that
yes.
would be the word.
Confidence.
But we'll hope we'll come back to that. But do you agree with me that they're both?
Absolutely.
It's both and.
Absolutely. And we're talking about that in the thread of coddling our kids too
yes,
much.
Yes, the new book that I've read, The Coddling of the American Mind.
Yes.
Yeah, which is tough and in itself controversial.
Sure.
You know, because it may be a little bit too far. But the basic premise I gathered from reading it was that, you know, we just are overprotective.
Right. And maybe not just of our children, sometimes of our friends or spouses or our older parents. I mean, I think sometimes as people, we want everything to be perfect and rosy. And so certainly when we're raising our children, we can be overprotective. We can solve their problems. We can do their homework. We can fix any challenge.
We don't want them to fail, so we do the homework.
Which is just so counterproductive
sure.
in the big picture of things. Why do we do it, Dr. Nick?
We do it because we love them and because there's something in us that does want to protect. And that's what makes it so hard to be a parent or a teacher or a counselor or anybody that's trying to empower someone. We have to say, you're going to get hurt. It's going to happen. But what happens when you get hurt? How do you do? You get called bad names. Do you immediately want to call the parent and say, don't you let your child call my son or daughter bad names? We got to deal with what they're going through and feeling first.
Right.
Huh? And then help them realize, well, you know, yeah, I've been called a few bad names in my life.
True.
I've been talked about in my life. So I don't want to diminish it, but it's like it's putting on some kind of thicker armor that I can deal with it.
Because life will throw them some curveballs and you won't always be there.
Right, right.
They're going to have to deal with things in the moment. But how have we changed as a society so much in just a couple of generations? I can tell you that my mom's parents would never have been the coddlers that this generation is. Never, never.
Whitney, I hesitate because I don't want to get too much into it, but I do think some of it really is the political correctness. We're supposed to say this, we're not supposed to say that. Mm. If we say this, we're being offensive to a particular group. It becomes very tribal. And so we're just overly sensitive. We're overly sensitive. We even now question a joke and say, well, that's not funny because it offends someone.
Right.
You know, I was just the other day, somebody took something from me and then gave it back. No, I gave somebody something and took it back. And he said, you're such an Indian giver. And even I started thinking, should we be using that phrase anymore?
Oh, right. Probably not.
It's offensive. And I'm not saying that we should or shouldn't.
Sure.
I'm just, as you said, we've moved into so many things are, we've got to be alert, sensitive.
Yeah, but you know, I also ask, because my grandparents were coddlers to my mother and her siblings. They didn't try to make the path so easy. But I'm gonna tell you one other thing and give me your thoughts on this. Their egos were not also so entrenched in their children.
Say that again.
My grandparents' egos were not entrenched in their children. I think that has changed. I would say that my generation, a lot of parents, their ego is in their kid and their kid's success.
Oh, yes. I'm with you now.
And, you know, are they the star football player?
Yes.
Are they the number one student?
I'm living through my children.
Yes.
Another way of putting it. Right.
And
instead of empowering them, again, and almost separating yourself from them, this is you.
Yeah, is that one of the reasons why we coddle more too?
That's a very good piece to that puzzle. I think it's a very good piece to that puzzle. Because remember, we live in a kind of a psychological, intimate, fulfillment, purposeful age, and nobody really has it completely.
Right.
So my child is gonna be it, you know, and it's like I'm gonna entitle you. But I'm also going to make sure you act this way.
Yeah.
And you come out this way for the sake of me.
Yeah, or how about you're going to be everything I wasn't. I wasn't the quarterback.
Yes.
I wasn't the star cheerleader.
Yes.
I was. So by golly, you're going to be because then I got a little piece of it.
Because remember, we're basically middle class whites. Think about how difficult it is to try to get children ready for the world when you're a single parent, when you work in three jobs, when you can barely make ends meet. Parents like that don't have time to sit and listen to their children because part of building resilience is listening and validating, It's not trying to fix. It's okay, you made a D. What can we do to get it to a C?
Mm-hmm.
I'm here with you. That takes time.
Right.
Effort.
Sure. Sure. Quizzing your kid on the information.
And also, getting back to what you said, I think it'd be hard for me if a son or daughter of mine came home with a D. I'd want to be shaking them and say, okay, I'm doing your homework from now on. Just because I don't want to fail. It's like you said, we're living through them.
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
Yeah.
I don't want to fail, so I'm going to make sure. It has nothing to do with me. It has to do with trying to get him or her to do better each time.
And you know, you and I have talked about this too. Sometimes we learn our best lessons when we fail.
We sure do. I remember saying this years ago, and an older gentleman who I loved to death was very conservative. I'm telling you, he nearly fell off the chair. He thought I needed to go into treatment because I said, what's the matter with failure? And he said, no.
It's not an option.
I don't know what happened to his kids.
Right. I would say they were their stress level was high. But so we don't coddle. You know, you mentioned the things we have to listen. What are some other things that we can do?
Well, I still think that, and maybe this is the Mr. Positivity in me, and even in the midst of the world sometimes being hostile and very dangerous and risky and it can hurt us, I still think we need to love life and trust life. And be able to say, I can handle this. Look at all the people. Look at New Orleans the other night.
Oh, my goodness.
I mean, and I know that maybe we worship the saints too much, but that city is back.
And that city was united in the fact that...
What a statement of resilience.
Yeah, I thought so, too.
The flood in Baton Rouge. I mean, I know people are still probably suffering from it, but I can handle this. Start all over.
Yeah.
There's something in us that still wants to live regardless of the risk. I just think we got to accept the fact there are some threats in life. So, and it's like, I'm ready.
That's it. And we have to get our kids ready.
Great
to see you, Dr. Nick.
Bye, everyone.
More Weekends with Whitney after this.